is definitely bot lane. Classic Suning fashion, we're going to see a carry top laner, but it's going to be the Fiora this time in the hands of Fit. What a comp! What a comp from Suning!
Now, super quick, when I look back, Bin has played 5 games of Fiora and only won 2 of them. SOFM, as far as I can tell, has never played Rengar in the LPL, but it was played in 2017 by Levi on the international stage. The trend of VCS junglers surprising and maybe defining what success can look like. Vedius, how do you think Suning's comp will play?
Why do you have to ask me?
Honestly, it's the most unfair question in a world final.
Oh man, like, we'll try and talk about these comps when we get into game, but like, I'm just gonna be honest and say like, this is a little unorthodox from what we've been seeing at Worlds, and I was not prepared for a Rengar versus Evelynn matchup. So let's call this a learning opportunity for everyone, because it's going to be a banger. That's all I can promise.
Now let's see exactly what SOFM, with the help of Bin and potentially Angel with that Syndra, can do. Obviously, execution will result how you at home feel about this pick.
So the thing is, the one thing I can say with certainty is playing side lanes becomes a lot harder when playing against an Evelynn, right? That's just rule number one. That rule applies to a Rengar as well, because he is just inherently very fast. The moment he ults, he gets to move around the map very quickly, and he can attack side lanes in the same way. So, like, this whole map dynamic becomes very, like, unique compared to what we've seen before, because typically, we've seen a lot of fighting for objectives, 5v5s around the dragons, but what you expect to happen is picks before, and then the objective comes after.
Yes.
So, like, expect to see a lot of Rengar hovering the Fiora in a side lane. You think that she is 1v1? No, that Rengar's going to be looming behind. And also in the early game, expect a lot of pressure to come out from champions like the Syndra and like the Jhin Leona bot lane, because there's a lot of ganks set up in mid lane as well. There's no cleanse on the Lucian, which means that if a stun does land, he's going to get one shot by the Rengar and the Syndra.
Vedius, Syndra, low mobility mage. Jhin, Aphelios, low mobility bot laners. And you've got Evelynn and Rengar. Whoever is able to get ahead could potentially just start to stomp the game. Wow. Suning with an early invade right now are contesting. Some damage onto Showmaker early. This will give a small advantage to Angel in the matchup.
So a couple things to note here. Number one, Suning doing an early invade onto Evelynn. I like this a lot. Evelynn is at her weakest in the early game. Rengar, not so much, but also you know you have a strong 2v2 in the bot side of the map. The good news for Damwon is that they know that this has happened. That little ward that spotted at the entrance wasn't actually sweeped out by Sword Art, so this means that the immediate response from Canyon can be to go through the top side. Look at the pathing that he took there. I'm just going to quickly draw it on the minimap. He kind of went around this ward, and he was just able to dodge out on that vision, which means that he was not spotted out. So Damwon are actually playing with full information control right now, whereas Suning don't share that level of info.
Now, Canyon, this is only the second time that he's played Evelynn. He played it once during LCK Summer. It was a win. He's going to be able to pick up his red buff, and you can see the map has kind of been split because of that invade, that information you talked about, Vedius, allowing Damwon, and specifically Canyon, to play quite safely with the help of Nogri and Showmaker shoving those waves in.
Exactly that, and I think that Bin recognizes this. Notice that he's just letting the wave being pushed into him. He knows that he is on the weak side of the map because of the potential split. Early level 2 from Suning
really
in the bot lane.
Damage coming up, that Dancing Grenade and the chunk onto Beryl, and look at the big wave. So if Beryl sticks around, I don't think they'll go for the dive with the Ignite though, but it is a threat and something to be aware of.
Keep your eyes on the top lane right now. This isn't a huge stacked wave, but Nogri is level 3. Canyon is also around. I don't think he's going to hit level 4 off the back of this. I think that he needs to clear at least one more camp to be able to get that, yeah.
Minion wave has been cleared out, and you
can... Yeah, okay, they're not going to go for the dive.
You
can
feel the tension in our casting already.
Well, I think that it's pretty safe to assume that the dive doesn't come through, because usually a gank doesn't happen before the Scuttlecrab is dead. Scuttlecrab is too important for junglers in the current meta especially to even risk giving it up, which means that with the priority that Suning do have in bot lane, SOFM's likely going to secure that one, and then the same on the top side of the map for Canyon. Now let's see if Suning can get a quick pick here. Beryl.
Beryl will spot out SOFM or vice versa.
Immediate
That's an insta-flash.
Yeah.
Insta-flash from Beryl. and it's the right call to do so. While you notice Canyon's on the top half of the map, also just quickly to point out, Showmaker, after shoving the wave into Angel, backed, picked up a Cull, and has teleported to lane very, very early. So he's sitting on the Cull on the Corrupting Potion, and you'll see Angel with his first back coming in right now.
So he's going to TP back into lane, as you were talking about. One of the other things I did want to note is that we've been seeing a lot of boots on Jhin's in lane, and the main reason why you run boots and health pots is because you get a lot of effective health by just trading, use the extra movement speed that you have, and then you get to just sustain it back up, which against things like a Doran shield doesn't really matter that much, but he's decided to go for the Doran's Blade, knowing that in this 2v2, he just has the advantage when playing up against an Aphelios. And I like the fact that we're seeing this, like, poise and aggression, because it also gives him a little bit more safety in the 2v2 as well.
I love the way Showmaker is playing that Canyon mid lane. He was leaning towards the north. Canyon's going to come in here to jump onto Bin. That's a lunge forward. He's going to be flashing towards support. Bin needs to continue chasing, and Canyon looks for a target. So gets the flash out of Noguri and is able to outplay, but I don't think he spotted Canyon yet. Finally will get the information and realize he needs to back away.
So this is a situation where I think Noguri actually messed up the trade a little bit, because Canyon was looking for a potential gank because Bin was a little bit overextended there. But because Noguri didn't take the trade that he wanted, he was forced to flash out. And that meant that Canyon only used the charm as a zoning method rather than a commitment. So that's not going to play out in Noguri's favor. He now doesn't have his flash. And now I'm going to keep my eye on what SOFM decides to do, because for the vast majority of this early game, it's been about the split map. It's been about basically enabling the bot lane of Huanfeng and Sword Art to just be as aggressive as humanly possible. And now Canyon has made his way bot. Bear in mind, he doesn't have stealth, but they do have the Lantern.
Lantern, Flay, Death Sentence connects onto Sword Art. Defensive flash from Huanfeng. Sword Art has already used his. Now he's running for his life. SOFM is inside the brush. And you see the respect from Damwon. Now, SOFM was on the Mountain Drake, and he's waiting in the wing. Sword Art looking for the cooldowns, and Canyon starts to back away. If Beryl steps forward, he is at risk of getting rooted in place, but will not do so. One, two, three summoner spells, four summoner spells secured on the side of Suni.
So I will say, this is actually a little uncommon for Canyon, because typically he is that very farm-focused jungler that prioritizes himself, and he wants level 6 as fast as possible on this Evelynn. But in a situation like this, he realizes that his bot lane is in real danger. He wants to try and get them out of a situation and also offer them the opportunity to reset, crucially, because now you can see the Aphelios gone back to base on the BF sword. And the purpose of that gank was not to get a kill. It was simply to alleviate pressure to allow Ghost and Beryl to reset, get back out onto the map. And now look, he's already in the bot lane. And remember, you ring the Beryl, quick shot. Look at where he is right now, already pathing up towards the top side of the map. They recognize that Noguri has a way. It's in a bit of an awkward spot, and he needs assistance, but Canyon needs to clear. So because Canyon can't cover, Beryl takes on those responsibilities, and he's now in a position where he can keep Noguri alive. The Drake goes down. They know exactly where SOFM is, so he now resets, passes his way back to bot lane.
Once the information is gained, Beryl can go back to supporting Ghost in the bottom lane. And, you know, a couple more backs have come in. Sorcerer's Shoes picked up by Angel in the mid lane. The Goro build for Bin. He's got himself three longswords and a Doran's Blade. Four of them in his inventory, and the Bramble Vest for Noguri. His flash is about halfway back from cooldown, and you can see Huanfeng as well as Sword Art. They just, you know, flirt with mid lane a little. There's no support, there's nothing else happening, but always showing support to the rest of the lane as the Showmaker has come back into lane with that pickaxe. So a lot more attempt at getting kills and advantages this game in comparison to the previous game, but that is obviously because of the drastically different draft.
So the things that Damwon needed to be concerned about in the early game was the 2v2 in the bot side of the map, while also potentially looking to get early kills onto the Fiora. So the good news for both teams is, number one, Fiora is thriving right now. She is very comfortable. She now is at a point where she should feel stronger against Noguri, even though he's gone for the early Bramble Vest. That just means that he's likely not just going to straight up die in the 1v1. But the same vein, the bot lane hasn't been punished, right? They've actually been able to get a nice reset on the BF sword. They've actually come away with all of their summoner spells, and they're feeling pretty confident. But now the junglers have hit level 6. This is where things start to get a little bit more interesting, because, of course, you can't ward for Canyon anymore. You have to have a control ward, and there are ways to navigate around that. Meanwhile, SOFM, he can literally just run down a lane and gank you. And the moment Sword Art hits level 6, that gank setup becomes very powerful in the bot side of the map. So the junglers start to make things a little bit more creative and a little bit more interesting. At least that's what I expect over the next few minutes.
I want to talk a little bit about Canyon and the vision, because you need information on Canyon's, you know, camps to really discern where he is. Thrill of the Hunt has been cast here by SOFM. He's going to look for a target. Curtain Call is used as the lantern will bring Ghost to safety. Despite a couple of shots tagging, I think the important takeaway there is, with nearly no AD on SOFM, he chunked Ghost for around 40% of his hit points with a single leap and savagery combo.
He's actually going for a tank build. Okay, so obviously most Rengars that most people will see is the full lethality one-shot Rengar, but in classic SOFM style, I'm not sure why I really anticipated him to go for any other style. He's the guy that will build tank on pretty much anything because he's very much about playing for his team. So by going for that play in the bot side, what of course it does give is information to Canyon that the Rift Herald is an option for him. So he's going to path it towards top, secure that objective, and that's going to assist down one a little bit later on. Meanwhile, he's going to go back and clear his top side while SOFM is looking to clear his bot side on the map.
Well, let's see how this next few minutes plays out. I do want to take a brief interlude to remind everyone of the Huan Feng. That's where you get into the enemy base in between their inhibitors, open up on Curtain Call to kill the enemies, when they're at their inner turret. 4-1 on the champion already, a 40 KDA. I mean, he has just popped off on Jhin all tournament long. And while he's 0-0-0 for now, you've seen how Huanfeng and Sora have been playing the lane. And he will be one of the people, I think, that'll combo with SOFM, you know, from range, with that Curtain Call. We've seen that option tried once, even though it didn't net a kill. You can already see how it can work out. And you can combine that with the long-range scatter of the week, or, you know, if Ben decides to jump in with the Grand Challenge as well.
That is true. I just noticed on the minimap, though, control ward, control ward, control ward. Suning's basically said, no, no, Rengar, none of that. We will not be ganked today. And they are just heavily committed towards the bot side of the map. And also, this suggests that they are looking at a potential second Drake contest. The question is whether or not they will actually commit to it, because I think at this point in the game, especially when you go for the Mora mana upgrade on Lucian, you're a little bit weaker in the early game relative to, I suppose Syndra, even only on a lost chapter, I suppose both mid laners are actually relatively weak, and it very much depends on the strength of the junglers. So we'll kind of see what both teams are feeling right now. Ghost and Bell have been able to gain a little bit more control over this side of the map, and a large part of that is because of the vision that we just alluded to. And SOFM not pathing that way. He's going to start heading that way now.
A lot of wards to clear out. I also think the fact that Huanfeng and Sora had to play without wards for a long time, ooh, that is an awful time to pause. As soon as I hear information, I will let you know. But yeah, I think important to call out Huanfeng and Sora out. Of course, they lost all of their Summoner spells several minutes ago.
Yep.
And that allows Ghost and Beryl just a little bit more time, a little bit more freedom and safety in that lane.
Canyon is breathing down the neck of Angel right now, and he may have absolutely no idea.
No, none whatsoever. And it is very interesting to see how Canyon is playing this Evelynn. We've already seen some small differences in his approach to the game with the gank down the bottom lane to alleviate pressure, as you alluded to already. It's only the second time that we've seen Canyon on Evelynn this year. And for the time being, neither team has a significant advantage. Love, love, love the Flash Wolves team logo. huge shout out to the history and legacy the Sword Art is obviously bringing into the game, as we can see the refs on stage talking to the players.
So to kind of recap what's happened so far in this game, like, as I mentioned, the things that both teams needed to be concerned about was, from Suning's perspective, they didn't want the volatile lane of the Fiora getting snowballed on, right? She's always going to outscale an Ornn, but the mid game can be very awkward if you put behind early. So when you split the map, of course, one of the dangers is that you can get very heavily punished up towards the top side. And I think that what his rune choice of going for a fleet footwork rather than grasp means that he can sustain off of the minions rather than just constantly looking for trades. So his whole game plan going into the game, and based on what the team is saying, is like, we're not playing around you. If you're going to pick a carry, you have to play safe, because if you fall behind, then it's going to be dangerous. And I think the Bin did a good job on the top side of the map, but the same was applied to Darmon. Darmon wasn't able to play through their bot side of the map because it was split on them, and the 2v2 had to play very safe on the bot side. Now, you kind of can have that perspective of, was Huanfeng and Sword Art not aggressive enough in the bot side, or did Ghost and Beryl actually just play very well in the defensive 2v2? And I think that either way that you look at it, both teams are pretty happy that their core carries were not actually put behind in the early game.
Thank you very much. Of course, that small start today was because we have found out from our producers that Suning did pause the game. It is related to a microphone issue. League officials are swapping the headset for Huan Feng and getting him back into game, back onto the team comms with the rest of the squad. And one of the things that I'm going to be very interested to see how this game plays out, like to my eyes, when you have an Evelynn or a Rengar that does manage to pick up a couple of kills, or even a Syndra, Lucian, to be fair, the kit and the way in which those champions play tends to be a little bit snowbally. If they get a kill, if they maintain vision, if they play and they make the right decisions, they can progress their lead significantly quicker.
Well, so Rengar is one of those champions that I feel, even if you itemize to deal with him, it's still not enough.
So you just hate Rengar.
Hate Rengar. I really hate it. I was playing Akali into a Rengar, and I saw him, and I thought, if I Shroud, I can avoid it. He one-shot me before my Shroud even came off. But the funny thing is, Evelynn could do exactly the same thing, just in a slightly different way. But the difference is that SOFM is not building one-shot Rengar. He's building tank Rengar. Now, a lot of stuff has just happened.
Oh, we're right back in. Teleports come down to the bottom lane. Flash has been used by Angel. Hopefully, we can find out exactly what.
But no one has died.
No first blood. All right, so brief pause. Huan Feng, he had a problem with his headset. It is fixed. We once again dropped in hot and fast, much like Picks and Bans. But nothing has happened,
so,
and Drake is available.
What we did see was Canyon hovering around mid, and based on some of the spells that suggest that gank was pretty successful, it forced Angel to burn everything. Now they're going for the kill!
Lost Caress picked up! Canyon gets first blood solo!
He will find that crucial pick, but I don't think it will be converted into the dragon, but they might not care. They're going to trade this Drake for a potential first tower.
Now, at what cost? First blood goes to, of course, Dom 1. The dragon, number 2, goes to SOFM, and while the Rift Herald got a couple of plates, it didn't secure the tower overall. SOFM is still lingering, and we saw Canyon just starting to back away to his Krugs. So it ends up being a 2,000 gold lead here for Dom 1, and here's a replay of the game.
So this is what we were talking about. Yeah, the instant flash coming out from Angel, showing that respect towards Showmaker and Canyon. He's now forced to play defensively, and this is the invisible pressure that an Evelynn can consistently generate. Meanwhile, in the bot side of the map, we saw quite a lot of action happening as well. It seemed like the Suning tried to counter a play, and we even got the teleport out from Showmaker and Angel towards the bot side of the map to create a lot of action happening. And it ended up actually costing Suning quite a lot. They ended up burning all their summoner spells on the bot side of the map. Huan Feng also ended up dying, which gave Canyon his first kill of the game. Going to be extremely valuable for this Evelynn as the game progresses. And also, first items are starting to come through as well. Infinity Edge now finished for the Aphelios. So Dom 1 once again kind of sitting pretty in this early game.
Yeah, feeling very comfortable with that 2,000 gold lead. Despite the fact Suning have got themselves two Drakes, I do think that is crucial. It will, at the very least, force Dom 1's hand, I think, to try and challenge. Or if Suning elects to play a little bit of a side lane type game, the fact that Bin has now completed his first big item return to the top lane, I think the scariness of a Fiora in the side lane with the potential of Rengar backing Fiora up can be another way in which Suning can play through this this game to try to look for an advantage.
Well, I think Suning still have the 4 Drake win condition, right?
Yeah.
They obviously have the first 2 Drakes, and I think that in terms of early control, they're sitting quite comfortably. I kind of wanted to see a little bit more aggression from their 2v2 bot lane. We haven't really seen many roams from Sword Art either, so like, they haven't been able to be as proactive as I think they would have liked to have been in the early game, and now Canyon has hit level 10 on the Evelynn, has the Sork Boots completed as well. Both junglers meet.
So much support. Ring the Barrel as he's in the mid lane, helping out on the Herald. SOFM will get support from Sword Art and Huan Feng. I'm waiting for that Solar Flare, and I was building up for the initiation, but Sword Art held the trigger, chose not to throw it down. He is, of course, the caller and sort of the captain of Suning. Many players actually call him the coach as well. Huan Feng in interviews has said the very same thing. It's great to see Sword Art in his first world final after years and years and years of attempts and regional success with Flash Wolves within the LMS.
For sure. And we kind of need to see a little bit more from him in this game. Like right now, the pressure is starting to mount. You can see 4 members on their way bot. They're looking to try and secure this tower. Vision is already being invested all across the board. And now Canyon has snuck his way in.
Look at the numbers advantage. Dom1, immediate reply. They challenged all the vision that Suning set up. If you've been watching for the entire game, Verius highlighted the control wards much earlier, saying, nope, SOFM, you shall not pass. You shall not go through the tri-bush. You shall not collect first blood. And very similarly, Dom1 brute forced their way into the river. Look at the ring of vision towards the Drake. They pick themselves up the first tower, and total gold, Ghost, Showmaker, Canyon, top three in the
But race. Compare Ghost to Huanfeng, and that's the most important thing. There's a 1.3k gold difference. That's basically a BF sword difference. Of course, you don't see it in the itemization, but like, it's a pretty big advantage in the bot lane, and for Dom1, this was the lane that they were most concerned about. Now we see both teams setting up for this Herald.
Herald is going to be the contest. The riposte comes out from Bin. Angel will be the target of the Kali.
Nice.
Sword Art finds Canyon before he can get a caress down. Now Sword Art will be the target. Ghost is able to get on the board with the first kill. That's a leap into a savagery. The bolus strike gets fired out. I think Beryl caught it. There comes the curtain call. Will be tagging one as Bin gets the first kill of the fight. And now all of a sudden Showmaker gets a reply back onto Angel. Flashing away as Ghost is the target of Bin. Huanfeng will not be able to find anybody with a deadly flourish. A leap onto Grom from SOFM. He's already burned the flash. Ghost is going low. The lantern to safety. He gets out. Ends up being a 3-for-2.
A lot of cool, clever things coming out from SOFM there, using the Grom to actually stack up his passive, and then he gets the root onto Ghost to force the cleanse out. Good awareness of how to take advantage of that Rengar pick, and that was a pretty big team fight win for Suning. They're going to close the gold gap just a little bit, but I think this was a a very aggressive contest from Dom1, because you have to appreciate that Beryl isn't here yet, which means that the immediate collapse onto Canyon was excellently done from Sword Art, and while he does get chunked out initially, this is where Dom1 feel that they have the numbers advantage. But here, SOFN then dives onto the bot lane. He's trying to zone them away from the fight, and he's trying to soak up all this damage. Showmaker then commits to trade his life, but then he's then able to get out thanks to the lantern. Then I love this commitment from Bin as well, because it splits up Dom1 once again. And then again, you'll see here from SOFM. Gonna land that root by stacking it up on the Gromp. And then he's forced to cleanse out. So big teamfight win for Suning. They'll be able to get the Herald, and it looks like that because they're able to reset first on the map, they're gonna get themselves third Drake. So even though they're at a gold deficit, it's kind of similar to last game where their kind of control over the map is seems a little bit stronger right now.
Zero towers to one, three kills to three. And this soul is probably going to be about 2 minutes slower than game one, but we're on for the same approach. Beryl was looking for a death sentence, unable to find a target, and SOFM is going to jump
hunting.
In. Thrill of the hunt, he's interrupted by the flare. Canyon will go golden and stay alive a few seconds longer, get locked up by the solar flare, continues to stay alive as Showmaker manages to outlast the burst from Angel. And as I was waiting for the fight to continue, it just disengages as quickly as it started.
The Hex Drinker from Showmaker really coming in clutch there to mitigate all of the burst that was coming out from Angel. So I feel like SOFM just has one build. But you know what? It works, okay? This man just dives into the face of his opposition and just soaks up damage. His goal is to be a nuisance. He does it on his Lee Sin, he does it on his Shen, he's gonna do it again on his Rengar. He just dives into the backline, and yeah, his flight, his jump gets interrupted by Bell, but it doesn't matter, because his W removes the CC from him, he's able to heal back up, and he's just like, hello, I'm in your face, I'm in your way, focus me. Oh, by the way, my carries are gonna kill you.
I actually think when you look at how much mobility has happened this game, the movements and the amount of time multiple members have roamed to top mid bot before 20 minutes, in contrast to game one, we're playing on a cloud rift. And I think those little cloud zones are going to open up this gameplay even more. And the thought of Rengar and Evelynn getting quicker into your face on the side lanes, it's going to make how effective Bin can be significantly more important.
Now you'll notice the Banshee's Veil has come through for Canyon because he recognized the amount of crowd control that is locking him down in these fights. And I think that Canyon has to be a lot more patient in these fights. And look what he's doing right now. Pay attention to the minimap. Hovering the Lucian in top lane. This is a very common Evelynn strategy where you just kind of shadow your solo laner so that when the enemy comes to match, you can pick. But again, SOFM gets to do exactly the same thing on the Rengar.
Yes.
He's going to spot him out with the ultimate. He's hovering around, and now he is covering for Angel. And this is what we talked about in draft. Both champions can do exactly the same thing where they just cover for their solo lanes, and that Evelynn becomes a lot less scary when it's not a 1v2, it's actually a 2v2.
On the assumption SOFM is reading the play, as long as he's there, of course, that's the important thing. So the information, the warding, very crucial. We caught a quick glimpse there of Bin, and something that I didn't get time to really celebrate, Bin's riposte to block the Allura from Evelynn in that previous fight, the reaction speed was fantastic. He's 1-0-2 on Evelynn, getting close to a Trinity Force.
You ran on the Fiora. Fiora,
thank you very much. Thank you very much. On the Fiora. And it's absolutely terrifying to think what a Fiora in a side lane can do. But Suning is still down 2.5k gold. So they do need to play around this next dragon. And they do need to find a way to deal with Ghost, who is getting a little closer to 2,000 years.
Ghost is the scariest point of Damwon's comp right now. I think that the thing is, Damwon, if they kind of just get to play their front-to-back teamfight comp, I think this is like the best position for them. Huanfeng against on the Jhin against an Ornn is not going to melt him at the same speed as an Aphelios is just going to melt through this comp from Suning. So I'm really curious as to how Suning are going to play out these fights. I think they need to look for a pick just like this.
That's a root, scatter the weak, unleashed power.
Excellent.
SOFM had Thrill of the Hunt and he was waiting. I think Showmaker used the Blast Cone into the river and unfortunately ran into SOFM. Call of the Forge God knocks up one, finally he had Flash. He didn't flash away. He gets caught, gets locked up, gets killed. But now the rest of Suning are arriving. Nogri's going to be the first target. That's a fantastic stun onto Beryl. The re-engage from Sword Art with the Zenith Blade. Beryl stays alive thanks to the stopwatch for a few extra seconds. And somehow Sword Art survives. Nogri continues to tank for days. There's not enough damage just yet for Suning to burn through the Ornn, and Ghost remains untouched. 50% of his HP not at death threat yet. And somehow that Ornn held all of the LPL back.
Yes, that was a really good choke point for Nogari to hold the line, because he made it impossible for Bin to actually dive onto the back line. And so these are the picks that we were talking about from Suning. This is exactly what they wanted to find. And you could argue there was a bit of a greedy path from Showmaker to go through the river rather than the long way around. But either way, he gets caught out of position. Looks like we're not going to get a replay of the fight, but I liked that Ghost used his ultimate when he had the purple gun. So he had the root to guarantee the knockup from Nogari. That meant that they could guarantee the kill, but it also meant that they were stuck underneath the tower. So this meant that Suning could look for a collapse, but then great patient play from Damwon allowed them to just disengage from that situation and able to escape with their lives. Now, a lot of summoner spells are gone. Ghost doesn't have his ultimate. Oh, but Sword Art definitely does.
Beryl was able to escape with the help of the Mikhaels, manages to escape Ghost, flashing cleanse available to him. And remember that that mid lane engage in tower fell 10 seconds before the Cloudrake spawns. This is the sole point, and Suning want to pick it up. Here comes Huanfeng, curtain call available to him.
Look at what Fiora's doing in the bot lane, completely zoning Nogari out of the fight. He's saying, no, 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 you don't get to go past me. Cannon's going to come down and try and help him out.
But there's a lot of damage being chunked down onto Bin. Nogari, 2.5k HP. Now he's going to peel back. Call of the Forge God a few seconds away. Sword Art looking for the Shield of Daybreaker. The Zenith Blade, he's holding onto it. Canyon is coming in from behind. He's got access to the Last Caress. He's looking for a target, and Angel Force to flash away to save his life. Sword Art will be the sacrificial support for Suning, and Damwon get their first dragon.
And once again, patient team fighting from Damwon allows them to come out on top, and they will be able to buy more time and secure themselves the fourth Drake of the game. They now have their eyes set on the Baron. Nogari more than capable of tanking this one up as well. And look at the guns the Ghost has. The Chakrams are ready to fly. He's going to throw that one down, and they're just going to melt through this Baron.
They will melt this one really, really quickly. No flash available.
Suning are going to spot this.
There is, of course, some vision being caught out. Death Sentence will connect onto SFM. He's charging up the bar. Bin has teleported into the top lane. 5,000 HP. The red buff is used to throw in. Beryl gets blown up by the ultimate, but there goes Showmaker. He's got one already. He gets a second onto Huanfeng. And the SOFM is in trouble, but the Baron has been stopped. Bin is being helped out, and the spit from Baron picks up the kill onto Nogari. Two members of Suning start to back away, and Sword Art's got a solar flare available. If Damwon can get behind these three, that solar flare can do work. But crucially, 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 the LPL have stopped the Baron.
I think the biggest thing there was Beryl. His positioning was not ideal. You can understand that he was trying to zone Suning away from the fight, but I think that that's not what he achieved. He ended up just dying and costing his team a lot. When we get the replay, we can actually break down exactly what happened. And I think the red buff was my favorite part of it when Angel used it to actually set up the play. So here we can see Beryl trying to zone SOFM away, but he's then just going to lock them down. Then the Jin W comes through as well. He tries to lantern in his teammates, but he doesn't actually come through on the backline. He gets shut down. Then, of course, Ghost and Showmaker are able to eliminate Huan Feng, but on the other side, Bin is 1v2 against Canyon and Noggery, and you can see that he quite easily wins that setup. So Suning in a numbers disadvantage are actually able to come out on top, which shouldn't have been the case. So Damwon misstepping there, perhaps trying to go for a little bit more than they could, and a slight misstep in terms of the execution allows Suning to keep the game going.
And they really do. It's still a 2,500 gold lead. Bin's gonna jump here on and gets the kill!
That right there is what we call an LPL Fiora, baby. Beautifully done from Bin. Procs the vitals almost immediately and is able to find a big kill. Now they can set up for a siege onto the tier one tower.
The amount of damage coming out, 3-0-2 for Bin's Fiora. I believe it was the last pick as well, if I recall correctly. And it's so far working out. Death Sentence connects onto Sordok, calls the Forge God from Noggery, prevents or removes any further engage. That will be a counter kill for Damwon. Now SOFM is in trouble. Death Sentence sidestep, beautifully done by Style of Me. He's looking for the re-engages. Here comes Bin! He's found Ghost! Ghost forced to flash defensively, gets locked up and rooted by the Bolo Strike and survives for now with that Molten Edge. Huan Feng is now trying to chase down Canyon, who's flashed defensively himself. Get the reload, get the shot. That's number three. Shot number four is available. Death Sentence onto SOFM. He's going to use the Battle Roar to escape. Jump forward, land the Savagery, but he cannot follow up with more.
Oh, wow, what a fantastic series. We have gotten non-stop fighting, and it feels like they never swing in either team's direction. Just so many outplays happening across the board. And it was Canyon that tried to dive onto the backline to get that kill onto Angel, but he couldn't actually shut him down. And the moment that he was revealed, he was quickly executed by Huan Feng. Meanwhile, all of the summoner spells were used from Ghost and Beryl to peel Bin off the backline, and there is no traditional front-to-back team fight here. Quick shot, it is chaos. It is all about the better positioning, and here we can see things start off initially, and this is where Ghost immediately cleanses. Oh my god, what a beautiful bowler strike. If it weren't for that exhaust, he could very well have died at the hands of Bin there. But you can see Canyon tried to dive onto the backline as well, and he just didn't quite land the damage, which meant that Huan Feng was able to clean up that kill on the back end. Of course, SOFM died as well. And you can see that Damwon, they do have the clear gold advantage, and a lot of that is sitting on top of Ghost. That is where the gold difference is. He's two levels above Huan Feng. He has two kills to the 1-3 scoreline of Huan Feng. He has a whole item completed over him. Like, it is between the 280 carries, but Bin is the power point. He's the one with three items, and he can take out Ghost alone.
Just before we carry on, 40 seconds until the next dragon, or I may not even get a chance yet. Ghost, of course, is really the difference maker here on Damwon since he's joined the squad. I'll get to that story later as the curtain is called. Bin looking for the engage from the back. He's going to jump forward. First kill on to Ghost. Now the tower will fall immediately after. Scatter the weak, stuns everyone. Call of the Forge God for the re-engage. That's Angel knocked up. Flash is not available. He's taken out by Showmaker. The melee in the mid lane, as there's already another kill onto Sword Art. There goes Showmaker as well. Bin is dashing and diving forward, looking for the vitals and plunging himself into Damwon. But the CC chain from Noggery takes him down. SOFM and Huan Feng, they're still sticking around. They've got minions to play with. 3 seconds until that Cloud Drake, and the call is to back away.
Towers mean nothing to Suning. The fact that they committed to that fight is just crazy. SOFM now trying to zone Canyon and Noggery away as Huan Feng looks to solo the Drake. Who else is on the way? Beryl is on the warpath. Ghost is going to be respawning soon.
He's got one more shot. SOFM, a full bar underneath. This is for the soul. Huan Feng reloads. One, two, throws out the grenade. Fire shot number two. The dragon's going low. It's picked up by Suning. They get themselves the soul. But
they can win the fight.
That's a flash forward. Huan Feng gets Canyon. Now Noggery's left inside the pit. Beryl's got no damage. SOFM steps back into the bush. Jumps onto Noggery. Jumps onto Beryl. Does it again. A multi-man stun once again from Angel. Beryl will be able to find the death sentence. That almost shuts down Angel. But there won't be enough from the Moonlight Vigil. And here comes SOFM looking for Beryl. Suning, get the soul.
There is a reason that he has style in his name, as he is styling all over Damwon with this Rengar pick. Suning with a huge team fight, securing the soul, will make the way to the Baron, and Bin's looking for another kill.
It's not over. Showmaker goes down. Bin finds a solo kill. Vedius, you've said it already. This is an LPL Fiora. Suning and Shanghai erupt. As the soul is secured, they peel back for
four
the Baron. It's
the
not
Fiora.
Done yet. Beryl will get caught up by that Zenith Blade. And here comes Canyon over the wall, throwing out Hate Spike after Hate Spike. I don't think you want this fight, fam, as Bin will melt you where you stand. The Baron is secured, and Su Ning will gain control for now.
Discipline has been the name of the game for Damwon consistently throughout this tournament. And even in this game, there has been a lot of it. But when you get down into the chaos, it is Suning's homegrown turf. The way in which they're able to play these small skirmishes, playing under this level of pressure, is where we get to see some of the best from the Suning squad. And just look at how much damage SOFM is tanking up, using the brushes to keep diving into the backline. His positioning is always great. And, you know, I had question marks around this tank Rengar build, but this is its purpose, to just be obnoxious, to buy time, and to secure that smite was huge for the side of Suning.
SOFM coming from the VCS, making a statement with Suning, and they are now in the lead for now. They've got the Clown Song, they've got Baron and Pard minions, but they still need to get through the rest of the base. It's only three towers apiece. They will find themselves a stun on Tanagri. He'll be rooted in place from a deadly flourish. But look at that, three, four members chipping away. Tanagri does survive a very long time. Cloud Soul plus Rift plus Thrill of the Hunt.
He is the fast Quake Shot. And meanwhile, Bin is just pushing in the bot lane, level 18. No one can stop this Fiora. He's even grabbed himself a Warden's Mail to mitigate some of the damage that's coming out from the double AD carries. You imagine that he's going to convert that into a Randuin to remove some of that crit threat. But, like, now Suning is in the driver's seat. They have the gold advantage. They have the Baron buff. Items have come in from across the board, and even with the Ornn upgrades, I don't think it's going to be enough to stop soon.
I really like how they're playing this as well. Now the dive comes in. That's the engage from Bin and SOFM. They'll kill off Beryl. With the Baron empowered minions, thanks in the mid lane, they'll secure that one as well. And now they continue on the siege onto the inhibitor turret. 5 versus 4, 30 second death timer for Beryl. Moonlight Vigil's available for Ghost, but he's waiting for the right gun. And Noggery is sitting on that call of the Forge God. If they don't blow up One Fang, SOFM, or Bin, really, I don't know if they can even win the fight.
I think Canyon needs to get a slightly deeper flank right now because his flank is too shallow. Suning is too ready for it, and he's not going to have any access onto the backline, which means that Suning can just keep walking in. He's not going to take that risk, and Suning, they're going to break the inhibitor. They're looking to take a game off of Damwon. They're looking to give us more games in this series.
Even out the series at 1-1. Now, they do need to get to the Nexus. The Baron will time out in 10 seconds, and the Red Bull Baron power play will cap at 4,200 gold right now. This is a tangible, meaningful, and important lead with 2 minutes until Elder. Think about how much damage this team comp has already,
yep.
Mr. Day. Now add the Elder Burst Assassination in combination with Syndra or Fiora or Rengar. That can be the final nail in the coffin for this game.
Whew. Man, it's just been such a like, I can't even really grasp how we even got to this point, because it feels like we've had so many crazy team fights and skirmishes that were actually so close. And the deciding point was actually just a 2 versus 3 at Drake, yes, which then immediately converted into a Baron.
That was after, what, a 5 versus 5 around
mid,
River?
That was, you know, just after another 5v5.
Right.
Like, it's just been a crazy game, and we saw a similar sort of path last game, but it was Damwon that kind of maintained control of the objectives, and this time Suning invested more into a stronger bot side of the map, and now they're looking for a fight.
All right, heal used by Huan Feng. He's got the flash as well. Zenith Blade will find a target. Scatter the Weak will not just yet. Here comes Bin. And Damwon on the full retreat. SOFM hops over the wall, finds himself a route to Tanagri. That means he cannot interrupt anyone else. He's being chipped
away,
melted. He's done, he's dead. That's it, Canyon's finished as well. SOFM hops forward. Ghost flashes defensively and rooted in place. Bin sends him
Penta.
Ghost gets caught out. That's the Quadra looking for it. Bin will pick it up. Get the Penta kill for Bin. And Suning Gaming in the World Championship Final. LPL Fiora, Suning step up, and with Rengar in game two, even out the series.
This is the LPL Fiora that we have heard so much about. My word, the pentakill at the end there for Bin really just sums up this series. It's just been nothing but skirmish after skirmish. That final team fight was just great patient play. Like the use of the Syndra ultimate to then set up for the stun, the Fiora diving onto the back line. Like, Damwon had no answers. We were excited to see this Lucian and Evelynn combo, and in the early game they found a couple picks, but they weren't actually able to snowball off the back of it. They weren't able to make those fights work, and the Rengar answer to be able to match on side lane
was exceptional.
SRFM's brain is too big for us mortals to comprehend.
Style of me. I'm trying to remember what Lyric said during countdown. Was that Suning were the B-sides, the alternative second record when you look at them in the LPL. When you see a Rengar Fiora, if that isn't the definition of an experimental second record, and to bust it out in game two of the finals, I mean, that is incredible. Look, Suning's Mercedes drive to victory, it was the Cloud Soul fight, and I'm hoping that this will be that 2 versus 3. But you could pick any of the skirmishes, any of the fights throughout this game, because it was literally bonkers.
So in this situation, Damwon know the barrel is on his way. But the problem is, it's an AD carry plus a tank Rengar, so there's just more damage as long as Huanfeng positions well. Kanyon gets a little too close to Huanfeng, and then the smite comes down from SOFM, and then notice flash in, immediate execute, and now they know, oh, well, actually, we now have the damage advantage, and just great use of the bushes from SOFM to just keep tanking up the damage, the constant spam of the W to keep his health high. Just really well played.
Really, really well done. And I think when you consider the intensity of these skirmishes and just how many moving pieces there are and how non-traditional they sort of are, it was great to see Suning execute very well, bounce back. That evens out our series at 1-1.
I mean, so it's funny because I was like, Dandy's Rengar back in the day was obviously very iconic, and like he even has a world skin for his Rengar, right? And like that's the last time we saw like one of those world-class Rengars, and now to get to see it from SOFM, it's just like, especially in the legacy of Dandy's fantastic jungle years, so like it's really cool. It's really
absolutely cool. This is League of Legends, and as we go to a break, there's something special we'd like to share for those of you who've always wanted to dive into the lore of Runeterra from Riot Forge and Airship Syndicate, a new cinematic trailer for Ruined King in League of Legends Story, the single-player turn-based RPG coming to PC and consoles.